The fourth Imam, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal also was of the same opinion. He was so strict that Abu Hanifa, Imam Abu Hanifa, he said, don't write my opinion unless it is confirmed, unless there is an ijma. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal was more strict because taqleed started. He said, don't write any of my opinions. If you find any of my opinion, whether it be for Imam Malik, or my opinion on Imam Malik, or Imam Shafi, Imam Abu Hanifa, go to their source. And if you find any of my opinion which goes against the opinion of Allah and His Rasul, you reject my opinion. That's the reason I say, I am 100% humbly. If humbly means a person who follows the teachings of Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, I am 100% humbly. Other people are 70%, 80%. So in teachings, if you say following the teachings of Abu Hanifa, Imam Abu Hanifa, may Allah's mercy be on him, makes you a Hanafi, I am a Pakka Hanafi, 100% Hanafi. If following the teachings of Imam Malik makes you a Maliki, I am a 100% Maliki. If following the teachings of Imam Shafi makes you a Shafi, I am a 100% Shafi. If following the teachings of Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal makes you a humbly, I am a 100% Sawfisad, humbly. Because all these four great Aimmah said, if you find any of my fatwa which goes against Allah and His Rasul, you throw my fatwa on the wall. See, all the madhabs of all these four great Aimmahs was what? What is the meaning of madhab? Madhab means way of going or time of going. Another word for madhab is sunnah. Even sunnah means way. Sunnah of the Prophet means way of the Prophet. So all the madhabs of all these four Aimmahs was the madhab of the Rasul. All the Aimmahs said, if you find a Sahih Hadith, you reject my opinion. That means all the four Aimmahs, their madhab was the madhab of the Rasul. Simple. The way of the Rasul. Imam Abu Hanifa, may Allah be pleased with him, may Allah's mercy be on him, he never came to start a new Hanafi madhab. Imam Malik never came to start a new Maliki madhab. Imam Shafi never came to start a Shafi madhab. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal never came to start a new Hanbali madhab. All of them followed the madhab of the Rasul. Like how the Christians misunderstand, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, never came to teach Christianity. He came to teach Islam. Similarly, all these four great Aimmahs, they came to give us knowledge of the teachings of Allah and His Rasul. Their madhab was no madhab but the madhab of the Rasul. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 4, verse number 59, Atiullah, Atiur Rasul, obey Allah and obey the Messenger, and those charged with affairs or with knowledge. You have to follow Allah and His Rasul. After that Allah says, and those who are charged with the affairs, those endowed with knowledge. But the verse does not end there. The verse continues. But if they differ, go back to Allah and His Rasul. So if those with knowledge, Imam Shafi, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, Imam Malik, Imam Hanbal, may Allah's mercy be on them all. If they differ, go back to Allah and His Rasul. So all the four Aimmahs, they said the same thing. If you find my fatwa which goes against Allah and Rasul, reject my opinion. Same thing Allah says, Atullah, Atul Rasul, obey Allah and obey the messengers, and those charged with their faith, those endowed with knowledge. But if they differ, go back to Allah and His Rasul if you believe in Allah and the last day. For this is the best and the correct way of determination. There is no better way of determination according to Allah than going back to Allah and His Rasul. It is so simple. Now, there are some brothers who come and ask me the question. Brother Zakir, fine. Those people who have knowledge of Quran and Hadith, for them it is very easy to know what is right, what is wrong, what is Sahih Hadith, what is Zayif Hadith. How can we, as lay Muslims, as common Muslims, understand what is right, what is wrong? It's a very good question. I tell them. Then they say, that's the reason we do taqleed. I tell them, see, what is the meaning of taqleed? Taqleed means, see, following the opinion of any scholar does not make you in the format of taqleed, doesn't make you muqallid. If after showing proof that the scholar you're following is wrong, and then you follow him, yet that makes you a mukhallid. For example, if your mother has a heart problem, fine, has a heart problem, and some doctor, what will you do? Who will you go to? You won't go to Tom, Dick, and Harry. You'll go to a heart specialist. You do research. MBBS? No, no, no. MD? Huh? MD. MD in what? In brain? No, no, no. Heart? Yes. So before going to a doctor, you do research. You check up what is his degree. MBBS? No, no, no. MD? Yes. MD in what? Gynecology? No, no, no. Kidney? No, no, no. Brain? No, no, no. Cardiologist? Ah, yes. DM? Super speciality. MD of medicine, then you do super speciality DM. You do your research and then you go to him. You don't blindly follow any Tom, Dick and Harry. If anyone on the street says, your mother has a heart attack, okay, do this. Will you follow him? Will you follow him? No. You will do research. Similarly, the third category, Atiullah, Atiur Rasul, obey Allah and obey the messenger. The third category, those endowed with knowledge or those charged with their affairs, you do research. Any scholar says anything, check up whether it's right or wrong. See, everything you cannot check up. Now you have heard 10 different scholars. You understand how scholar number A, he has given about 30-40 references. I have checked up 20. 20 or Quran say hadith. So 21st you need not check. You check scholar number 2. Scholar number 2, mixture. Part correct, say hadith, part zaif hadith. Third scholar, majority. Pulling fast ones. Sahih Hadith, it's not there. Bukhari, you open Bukhari, more than 7,000 Hadith, you don't find it only. So you have many scholars, you do little research. Now once you make up mind, scholar number 1, when he talks, he gives references. When I checked up the references, Quran, Sahih Hadith. Then what happens? Then when you ask an opinion and 3 scholars give you the opinion, you automatically follow the first scholar. Because I've checked up 20 things of his, it has turned out to be right. Even the 21st inshallah will be right. So every layman cannot do research on everything everyone says. So first, but you have to limited research. This scholar number A, he speaks on Quran and Hadith. Scholar A, B, C, D, or scholar number 1. Scholar number 2 or scholar number B, partly right, partly wrong. Scholar number C or scholar number 3, majority wrong. So you do little research and classify which type of a scholar is he. And then if you follow without doing research scholar number 1, no problem. But suppose you follow scholar number 1, you have done research on. Another scholar comes and says, what scholar number 1 has said is wrong, I give you proof from Quran and Sahih Hadith. You check up the proof. If it is wrong, you reject him and follow scholar number 1. But if the proof that fourth scholar gave you, it is from Quran and Hadith, going against the opinion of scholar number 1, then you reject the fatwa of scholar number 1. So if, see for example, I am there, when I hear something, what I speak in the talk, I do my research. But there's more knowledge in my head, in my brain, which I haven't checked up. But yet, I classify. For example, if I hear a statement from Sheikh Nasiruddin Albani, MashaAllah, who expired recently, according to me, is one of the greatest muhaddis of the recent times. So what he says, I follow on the face of it. Because I've checked up, he's a scholar, MashaAllah, following Quran and Sahih Hadith. But if someone gets me a fatwa against Nasiruddin Albani, if it's from Quran and Sunnah, I may reject the fatwa of Nasiruddin Albani. I know, see, every human being can make mistakes. Imam Shafi made a mistake, Imam Abu Hanifa made a mistake, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal made, Imam Malik made. So why can't Sheikh Nasiruddin Albani make? He can make. But he belongs to the group of scholars which